Good morning. This is ECE 402, Lecture 25. Today I want to talk about modulation synthesis, and like it says here, the course packet has information on this topic, but you're only responsible for what I actually talk about in lecture out of that. So I want to talk about ring modulation and amplitude modulation. The term ring modulation is something that musicians often use. The word ring there comes from the fact that this kind of modulation was originally done in analog synthesizers using a ring or a ring shape of four diodes. But at this point now, what does ring modulation mean? Well, if we have modulation here, the output is some sinusoid, often called a carrier by engineers, some sinusoid multiplied by a modulator, S of T, but there might also be a constant here. So if D is zero, then that's what musicians normally would call ring modulation. If D is non-zero, musicians would normally call this amplitude modulation. All right, so let's go through this example here. If we start off here, say we have this spectrum here. It's 114 hertz harmonic sound, and so this S of T, the signal that we're going to multiply by a sinusoid, is 114 hertz harmonic sound. So we have the fundamental here, 114, and then 2 times, 3 times, 4 times, 5 times that, basically n times 114 hertz in that sound. Now, we draw the spectrum this way, but what about negative frequencies? You know, a lot of times, engineers especially, will draw this negative spectrum. And it looks just like the positive spectrum. It's another copy of it. So what are negative frequencies? It's actually something to think about if you're going to do music. What are these? What do negative frequencies sound like? And as you may know, the negative frequencies sound a lot like positive frequencies. In fact, if you think about going through a sine wave backwards, the overall shape you get, if you're going backwards through it over time, is very much like going through it forwards over time. So there is sort of this question of, well, if they sound the same, and in fact, if they match the positive frequencies here, why do we even bother drawing them? The answer is, well, often we don't. You know, you might have a graph that just shows the positive frequencies. But the math often produces these negative frequencies, and you know from a previous lecture where we talked about aliasing and that sort of thing, there's lots of reasons or lots of times we see these negative frequencies. Here it's especially useful to actually consider these negative frequencies and not just ignore it, and because, well, it's a useful mathematical trick. When we look here at the carrier spectrum, it's a single sinusoid, right? This cosine here, single sinusoid, single frequency. So if we do a multiply in time domain, that's a convolution in frequency domain. And that's what we end up with here. Now you'll notice that once we multiply by this sinusoid, by this 1,000 hertz sinusoid here, we have the positive spectrum and the negative spectrum. Except, well, this isn't negative anymore. It's shifted, right? Because we did a convolution of this. We actually really see these negative frequencies, and we can see why when it's centered around zero hertz do we also want to consider the negative frequencies. Well, it explains where these magic things came from. When you convolve with a 1,000 hertz sign, you get the lower side band and the upper side band. What over here was the negative frequencies and the positive frequencies convolved with multiplied by this carrier gets you a copy of this spectrum shifted up around 1,000 hertz. All right. So you got lower sideband and upper sideband. Where does the lower sideband come from? Well, those are what we were calling negative frequencies here. And the upper sidebands are the positive frequencies all shifted over or copied, this spectrum copied over around 1,000 hertz due to the multiplying time domain. So now, there's a question here. This is what we would call ring modulation in music, usually, because with this capital D is zero, right? What would it look like if capital D were not zero? Well, all you do is you get some of the carrier directly in the output. So some of this 1,000 hertz guy, you would get, depending with amplitude D here, you would get another component here right at 1,000 hertz. That'd be the only difference. All right, there is this topic of single sideband modulation. You don't see too much of this stuff anymore, but I wanted to mention it because it was more of a topic in analog synthesizers and an early in some early digital. But the idea here is, what is single sideband modulation? Well, what if you want to do this modulation here, but you only want to end up with upper sideband or only end up with a lower sideband? So you can do single sideband modulation. And how would you do that? I'm just going to give you sort of the idea of how this works and point out some things about it. The exact circuits actually have a lot of issues with them where you'd really have to study specifically different circuits to do this. But I want to give you the underlying mathematical idea. So there's a thing we often call a cosine spectrum, a sine spectrum. What does that mean? Well, here, cosine spectrum and sine spectrum, what we do is we take an input signal. If we shift it by, if you have a positive 45 degrees phase shift, then that gives you the cosine spectrum. Negative 45 degrees phase shift gets you the sine spectrum. Basically, the important thing is these two are 90 degrees out of phase, right? The input signal here, all the components in this are 90 degrees out of phase with the same component in this one. Now, when you do a 45-degree phase shifter here, how is that different from just a delay? It's very important that those are not the same thing at all, right? A delay, say a constant delay, z to the minus 1, one sample delay. How many degrees phase shift is that if you just have a single sample? Well, it depends, right? If you delay for one sample interval for a very high frequency, that's a lot of phase shift. And for a very low frequency, one sample is very little phase shift. Now, if you want to do a constant phase shift across all frequencies, that means that the delay through this unit has to be different amounts, has to be much shorter for high frequencies than for low frequencies. So this is a non-trivial thing. This is not just a straight delay. That's the main thing I want you to be aware of. And you can look up phase shifters and various ways to implement them if you're interested. Once you've done that, and you have these two 90 degrees out of things, out of phase things, then you can modulate here with either a cosine or a sine. And the sum of the two gets you only the lower sideband, and the difference of the two gets you only the upper sideband. Why is that? Well, it's based on these formulas that you well know. That cosine A plus B equals cosine A, cosine B minus sine A, sine B. Right? So look at that. Make sure that you see how these two are related. So in previous lectures, when we had these 90 degrees out of phase components, they're sometimes also referred to as harmonic conjugates. So where you substitute sine for cosine. All right. I want to talk, that was amplitude modulation and ring modulation. Now I wanted to talk about frequency modulation. We'd seen frequency modulation before. There we go. At this point now, I want to go into much more detail about it. When we talk about, in the first part of the course, about frequency modulation, we had what looked like two phase oscillators, one here and one here, and the first phase oscillator would feed into the frequency of the second. So what does this mean? You have some carrier frequency here, and the modulator is outputting a sinusoid, so that's an offset to the carrier frequency, right? The carrier frequency here is very slowly changing, almost DC, but you have a much faster variation here. So this, if the modulation frequency is sub-audio, then this would sound like a vibrato, because it'd be periodic variation on the carrier frequency. But if you do this, if you do FM here at audio rate, then you get a spectral change here. So there are reasons to implement this differently than we originally said, though. Here we have this feeding into this upper plus. You can actually feed it into the lower, into an adder here after this digital integrator here. And there's advantages, numeric advantages, to feeding it into lower. You put it, if you're putting it in here, any errors in the signal, any round-off errors and the table lookups or whatever it ends up being, and any errors you put into the signal here are not integrated, right? Here, if you feed in any errors, well, they're going to keep summing up over time. And so this is a more accurate and a better way to do it, feed in the lower branch here. It's kind of funny because we still call this FM when you feed in the lower branch here. But actually, it's phase modulation. Right, this is a phase going into here. The frequency is what goes into here. So, but we still call it frequency modulation, even though if you wanted to be picayune about it, it's really phase modulation. There is a question: does it sound the same feeding in down here and up here? And the answer is yes, it is really the same, except for math errors, as long as you put the right modulation amplitude. You do have to adjust the modulation amplitude depending on whether you're feeding in up here or down here. But you can believe this is true, right? If you take a sinusoid and you stick it into an integrator, what comes out of that? Well, another sinusoid. And since we're doing a modulation here with a sinusoid, it turns out, yes, sinusoidal modulation, you can do the equivalent things feeding in up here or feeding in after the integrator. And that's just because the integral of a sinusoid is another sinusoid. But there are other advantages to feeding in here and doing what would, strictly speaking, be called phase modulation. So if we feed in to the upper branch, we have a thing, we'll call this modulation amplitude. It's usually called delta FC. So that's the change in the carrier frequency, right? Because it's an offset to the carrier frequency for the upper branch. So let's call that delta FC. And this is fine. It turns out, though, that when you use this upper branch and you're feeding in there, then when you play different pitches, like if you play a higher carrier frequency or a lower carrier frequency, you really have to adjust how much your this amplitude, the modulation amplitude, where if you feed into the lower, you get this extra freebie. This is kind of cool. We call this a modulation index, this amplitude, when you're feeding into the lower. And compared to the original, you got delta FC over FM. So you're dividing out the frequency of the modulator. Dividing out the frequency of the modulator. And what that means is you don't have to adjust, I said it incorrectly before, here you'd have to adjust a delta FC depending on changes to FM. But you don't need to do that if you're feeding in the lower branch. So what you really want to keep constant, or what you really want to control, is this I. And the lower branch, that's what the coefficient here is. The I is called the modulation index. And if you use the upper branch, the modulation index, you have to multiply I by, to get the delta FC, that's I times FM. So if you use the upper branch, whenever you change FM, you also have to change this delta FC. Lower branch has math and convenience advantages. So yes, the coarse packet sinus does this. Even the Egan matrix, some of the sounds do FM through the top. It works, but the bottom is usually better. So using the lower branch, we can make an equation for this above here. So you got 2 pi FCT. So this is the sine function here, right? This is that table look up, that sine function. 2 pi FCT is the carrier integrator here, right? Now, this is assuming FC isn't changing at all. We'd have to draw an integral symbol here. But let's for now just say FC is constant. So then after T periods, the integrator here is added up T times. So you got 2 pi FCT plus I times this sign here, the carrier, right, where I is this amplitude here. So this is a bottom branch thing. Why is it a bottom branch thing? Well, if we're a top branch thing, this whole quantity here would also have to be multiplied by this T, but it isn't. So this is an equation that's really equivalent to the above. Please stop the video now and look at that if that doesn't make any sense yet. Okay, so so this here has a sum of sinusoids. So when you do FM, you get a sum of sinusoids. What is the deal here? You get infinite number of sinusoids, which tells you that FM is always aliasing. But if it doesn't alias too much, if you don't hear it or it doesn't bother you, then hey, that's fine. But there are infinite number of partials it makes here. Now, each of these partials has a frequency and an amplitude associated with it. The amplitude is J sub k, is a Bessel function as of the modulation index. Okay, so k is for the kth harmonic from negative infinity to infinity, J sub k of I of the modulation index times sinusoid, and what's the frequency here? This part in here is the frequency. This is the carrier frequency plus k times the modulator. So this is pretty straightforward. Say the carrier and the modulator are the same frequency. This gets you a harmonic sound. And here are the amplitudes for each harmonic. So, you know, it's not too bad. All right. So let's look at these Bessel functions. It might have been a while since you've looked at Bessel functions. Here's a graph of Bessel functions. Here, J sub 0 here starts at 1 and then kind of wiggles down here. Decreases down to 0 till about a little over 2. And actually, this first part of it here is very important for FM because if you look at the first part here, J sub 0 here starts at 1 and goes to 0. Meanwhile, all the other ones, J sub 1 starts at 0 and pretty quickly increases. J sub 2 increases a little slower, increases a little slower and a little slower and a little slower. But if you look at this function here, what is this telling you? Well, it's telling you that, let's say FC and FM are the same, the carrier modulator are the same, then it's telling you that the fundamental frequency is decreasing in amplitude as you increase I, and the harmonics are increasing, higher harmonics increasing slower. And that's true up to about here. So here you've got the good behavior that I'm talking about here of J sub K of I when I is less than 2.4. I is really related somewhat to brightness, right? As I increases, the sound gets brighter. Fairly uniformly, fairly nicely. So, what we're going to do is we're actually going to compute what are the harmonic amplitudes. You have this table here. So, if you know this horizontal axis here is I, or X, you can look up depending on what your I is, depending on what the amplitude of the modulator is here. You can look up what are these values here. But the sub k here is a bit problematic. First of all, you can have negative k's, and they go with alternating sign, or in other words, according to this, j sub never k, j sub minus k is the same as a positive k minus 1 to the kth power here. So if k is odd, then it's negative. If k is even, then it's exactly the same, positive j sub k. So that's one thing to know. And another thing to know that you certainly know, but it's easy to make a mistake here, is the sine of a negative angle equals negative the sine of a positive angle. So what we're going to do then is we're going to try to figure out what are the frequencies present in an FM sound. Well, that's pretty easy. It's FC plus KFM. And we're also going to look at, well, what are the amplitudes of those of the harmonics, if it's a harmonic sound? So, know how to do this with out sine or sine errors. This is always easy to make mistakes in this. So I'm going to give you some examples. In this case here, we have a table. This is the same sort of information as on the previous page, but in table form. Most calculators don't have Bessel functions on them. If yours does, that's great. If not, you can look it up in the table here. So if we're going to compute FM spectrum computations, again, these top things here are copied from the previous page. This is the frequency of the partials. For k, and you got k going negative infinity, infinity. So one of the things that happens here is you got to watch out for negative and positive frequencies. When you have a negative frequency, yeah, it sounds the same as a positive frequency. But what happens if you have, say, negative 300 hertz and positive 300 hertz at the same time? What happens to the amplitude there? We'll do this in the examples here, but be careful. Right, you don't hear negative frequencies separate from positive frequencies. They're sort of the same thing, but there's constructive or destructive canceling going on there, so you want to be careful there. So what frequency partials do you get if the carrier frequency is 500 hertz and the modulator is 300 hertz? What is the fundamental? So that's the first thing to figure out, is like, if you're making harmonic sounds, well, what is the fundamental? Now, an easy guess is, oh, well, what is it when k equals 0 here? Fc plus k is 0 fm. So Fc is, in this case, 500 hertz. So you say, 500 is the fundamental. But that's not correct. 500 is not the fundamental. Okay, so k equals 0 doesn't correspond to the fundamental here. What you need to do is figure out the first, you know, handful of components. What frequencies are they? And from that, then, you'll be able to figure out what the fundamental is. So for k equals 0, it's 500 hertz. For k equals 1, you have Fc plus 1 times 300 hertz, right? So for k equals 1, you got F equals 800 hertz. Make sure you see that, right? This is the frequency here. K equals 1, Fm is 300. So k equals 2, you get 1100 hertz. K equals 3, it's 1400 hertz. You can check these. But now you also have to do the negative k's. For k equals minus 1, you have 500 plus negative 1 times 300, or you got 200 hertz. K equals 2, you got minus 100 hertz. K equals 3, you get minus 400 hertz. K equals 5, you get minus 700 hertz. So what do you got here? Well, your lowest frequency is 100 hertz. Then you got 200 hertz. Got no 300 hertz. That one's missing. But you got 400 hertz here in the form of negative 400. You got 500 hertz. I don't see any 600, but you got a 700 hertz, 800 hertz. So the fundamental frequency must divide equally into all of the above. And in this case, it's clearly 100 hertz. Okay, make sure that makes sense to you. Okay, so the next thing we can do here now is, assuming you do hear a fundamental. You don't always hear a fundamental. It's possible to do FM where there just aren't enough, there isn't a common divisor among all those partials you're getting, and so you don't really hear a clear fundamental. But what is fundamental if you have the carrier is 200 hertz and the modulator is 280 hertz? We go through the same exercise as before. For k equals 0, well, it's just Fc up there. So for k equals 0, it's 200 hertz. For k equals 1, it's the Fc, 200 hertz, plus 1 times Fm, which is 280 hertz. So you got 480 hertz. K equals 2 at 760. For K equals negative 1, you have 80 hertz. Well, negative 80 hertz. For K equals negative 2, you have frequencies negative 360 hertz. So now you have to figure out what divides evenly into all of these. And you come up with 40 hertz as the divides into all of them. 40 hertz is pretty low. So I don't think you'll actually hear 40 hertz as a clear pitch. But if you do hear a clear pitch, 40 hertz is, that's going to be the fundamental. Okay, so now let's do the more difficult one. this is somewhat fiddly to figure out what are the amplitudes of the actual partials. Now, this seems like, you know, kind of an icky exercise, and yeah, maybe it is, but it turns out that even in the academic world, for years when people were sharing FM sounds, they didn't realize that lots of details in this make a huge, huge difference. Like the modulator is a sine or a cosine. Basically the phase of the modulator and phase of the carrier matters. How the harmonics, what we're about to do here, all these things matter a lot, exactly what spectrum you're getting. So it is important to decide on exactly what form. In this case, we decided on this form here, sine and modulated by sine. Decide if they're sines or cosines or what they are, the carrier and the modulator. And then it's good to actually be able to figure out what are the amplitudes of the harmonics. So let's say here, what is the frequency and amplitude of the fundamental if the carrier is 100 hertz and the modulator is 100 hertz and I is 2? Okay, so the carrier and modulator are the same. And it's quite quick to see up there. Everything is going to be multiples of 100 hertz. So so we're good. You can go through the same way we did before. But now I equals 2. And the question is, what is the amplitude of the fundamental and of the 100 hertz? And that is a bit... you have to be careful here. There are two K values which contribute to 100 hertz. Certainly K equals 0 is 100 hertz, but you also have to worry about K equals minus 2, which gets you the minus 100 hertz. Because you got a negative 100 hertz and a positive 100 hertz, and you're only going to hear 100 hertz. What is the final amplitude here? So for K equals 0, the amplitude is J naught of 2. You can find that in the table here. If you do J naught of 2, you got 0.2239. Okay, so that's J naught of 2. For K equals minus 2, the amplitude is J sub minus 2 of 2, which is minus 1 squared times J2 of 2. So J2, watch out, it's J2, not J0 column, J2 column, and you go to 2, you got 0.3528. So that's clear, but be very careful about the sign. Is this a negative or a positive 0.3528? And because the subscript is 2, and by the formula at the top of the page here, this one, we know that minus 1 squared gets you just J2. For K equals minus 2, the amplitude is 0.3528. But wait, there's more. We're not done yet, right? This is the amplitude of a negative frequency. So now if you want to compute the total amplitude from these two contributions, we have to watch out because K equals minus 2 is for minus 100 hertz. And we have that sine equal of minus alpha equals minus sine of alpha. So we have to subtract that amplitude here from the other. So so the overall, if you want to talk about a positive sine wave frequency at 100 hertz, J naught 2 minus J minus 2 of 2, which is 0.2239 minus 0.3528 is minus 0.1289. So this answer is negative. So that's kind of weird. We have a negative amplitude for our harmonic. Well, that's okay. It's the same as a positive amplitude for the sinusoid 180 degrees out of phase. So normally when we talk about spectra, we use positive amplitude values or magnitude values. But basically, and then this would be put into the phase value. All right. But be careful of this. It's a tricky thing. And of course, it's a favorite kind of exam question because it's straightforward to grade. But be careful of getting all your signs right. Look at this again before the final exam. I wanted to talk some about more applied practical things. I want to talk about simple FM spectra and just what does it sound like. Like a lot of times FM is used to try to imitate other sounds because of all sorts of different structures you can do with FM. There's a lot of variety in FM, but I want to show you just really simple FM. So this is one modulator, one carrier, like we had the picture two pages ago. And we're just changing the modulation index I. So one thing to keep in mind is if you gradually change modulation index I, in this example here, you've got a carrier at 1,000 hertz and a modulator at 100 hertz. With a small modulation index, you see the 1,000 hertz, but it's modulated. You see some other partials here. As you increase the modulation index, you see more, and eventually you see lots of partials here. And in fact, what pitch is this going to be? And what frequency are you going to hear? Well, 100 hertz, right? Because the carrier is 1,000 hertz, but the modulator is 100 hertz, and all these are 100 hertz apart. This will probably sound like 100 hertz too, although with very little low end. Not sure if you'd hear 100 hertz in that one or not. But again, just keep in mind the carrier frequency is not the fundamental. So I'm going to play you some FM noodling, and much of what you hear here is just finger changing modulation index as you go. Is it electronic? Well, very much so. But it's a very beautiful, in its own right, electronic sound. So this is Ed Egan noodling around with very simple FM. There's also some quite iconic FM sounds. I'm going to play you just the intro to Whitney Houston's Greatest Love of All. This is the FM piano on the DX7. And is again, it doesn't sound like an acoustic piano, but it is quite iconic sound in its own right. technical difficulties. Just a second. Come on, you. Okay. That was not Whitney Houston. Here we go. Try again.
I believe the children are...
All right. So that's probably a FM sound that you do recognize from the DX7. As we talked about in the history part of the course, the DX7 was a huge success when it came out. There are many different kinds of FM that you can analyze and try to work with. Here is multi-operator FM. Here's a Formant FM example. This is an example that's popular because it sort of intuitively makes sense. It's fairly easy to set up. So let's just go through this example. Say you want to play 100 hertz fundamental frequency with three formants centered at these three frequencies, 400 hertz, 900 hertz, and 1250 hertz. How would you do this with FM? So say you wanted to do this kind of thing. It's 100 hertz fundamental. So all of these parcels that you have here are 100 hertz apart, but you have three different formants with their own bandwidths at these three frequencies. Okay, so how would you do that? Well, the first thing, because you have all this 100 hertz spacing here, if you make your modulator 100 hertz, right, that'll get you this spacing here, because remember, for each of the carriers, it's K times the modulator. So you get these different, you get 100 hertz spacing between partials. And then you can feed that one modulator into three different carriers. So the first carrier is at 400 hertz. That's going to be the center here. And as you increment its I here, its modulation index, you can get different bandwidths around 400 hertz, right? Because like we said at the top of the page here, as you increase I, this is low, this has few partials around it, more partials. Well, you can do the same thing here. If you want a wider bandwidth F1, you increase this I1 here. And then and as long as you don't increase too far, as long as you stay in the region where it's well-behaved, modulation index of less than 2.4, you can widen and narrow that. Same thing for F2 here. It's at 900 hertz. And again, this one's wider, so you can tell I2 has a bigger value than I1 does in this example. For I3, you have the same thing again. Now, one thing you got to do, because you need harmonics, you just round off. We said the third one, the formant is centered around 1250 hertz. Round it to 1300 or to 1200, either one, and then work with that. So you get the formant, so you get about the right thing, but you keep it all harmonic. All right. Let me know if that makes sense to you, or ask me if things don't make sense there. Okay, when John Chowning at Stanford made the patent for FM, he wanted to show, I mean, FM had been done for radio and for lots of other things, but he wanted to show examples of particular parameters, if you use a modulator and the carrier in the audio range, particular examples of what modulators and carrier you would use, and that might sound reminiscent of certain instruments. So for instance, here you have a trumpet. And what we have here is we have solid lines in these graphs, and some of the graphs also have dashed lines. When the solid and dashed lines diverge, the solid lines are the modulation index, and the dashed lines are the amplitude envelopes of the carrier. So this is here the modulation index and the amplitude are the same. And yeah, so basically, as you start up the trumpet sound, the modulation index goes up with amplitude, making a brighter sound and a less bright sound. This graph here is taken at a time at the peak here, and here's actually something sort of interesting. These amplitudes are not symmetric, right? The carrier is 1760 hertz. The modulator is 440 hertz. Why are these amplitudes not symmetric? Again, it's because of how we computed before, because those negative frequencies over here are sometimes adding in, sometimes subtracting out from the positive frequencies. And that's why you get this. So in the bassoon sound here, it stays bright. So the modulation index stays up here as the sound or the carrier amplitude goes down. That's all that is. And again, here's a spectrum at the peak. Here in the clarinet, you start out very bright when it's quiet, and then it stays quite constant, where the amplitude envelope looks like that. Notice here for the clarinet, by using a carrier of 900 hertz and a modulator of 600 hertz, the fundamental is 150 hertz, and we're only getting odd harmonics. So again, you can get something that's clarinet-like, that has only odd harmonics quite easily with FM. And then this is actually that example that we had, is the bell, or maybe better called chimes, with 200 and 280 hertz. All right, so those are some standard examples. If you wanted to, in the Egan matrix, you could go in and try to do some of these examples. Although, you know, if you really want to model sounds, I think physical modeling might be the way to go. But still, these are interesting to experiment with. They won't sound real close to these sounds, to a bassoon or a clarinet, but it'll be reminiscent of that. And in the end, you know, if you want a real bassoon or a real clarinet, hey, there's enough of those around. But if you want an electronic thing that's sort of reminiscent of it, but still clearly electronic, this is a nice thing to investigate. I want to say something about this final homework here. This is the last homework that you need to do for this course. And this one is about musical filters. We're going to talk some more about it in lecture two, but about especially terminology that you wouldn't have seen in EC310 or other filtering courses, like what half power excursion is, what transparency is, and those sorts of things. So I would highly recommend, if you have the time, to check out all of these Dottaro papers, not just this part. This is just sections 2 and 3 of one of those papers, but there's useful information in those, real practical information that you can use, for synthesis or for reverb or for various things. So please, take a look at that. Thank you very much.